Courtney Murdoch from Love Lives On, and today I am speaking with Andrea Warnick. She is a nurse psychotherapist, an educator, a volunteer, a thanatologist with over 20 years' experience in supporting grieving children. So welcome, Ms. Warnick, and thank you so much for joining me today.
My pleasure.
So the first question I have for you is, what advice can you give to parents on how to talk to children about the death of a loved one?
Really, one of the biggest pieces is just to be honest with kids. Yeah. In our society, we often think that we need to shield kids from issues related to death and dying. And what I know very well from my personal and professional experience is that doesn't tend to go well. Mm-hmm. When you don't tell kids what's happening around them, often they're going to imagine. If they're living in a family where somebody has a serious illness or someone's dying but nobody's talking to them about it, it's not unusual for kids to think up scenarios in which they're responsible
right.
for what's happening. You know, they're going to put pieces together when they're not given information. Mm-hmm. And so it's really important that we create an environment where they know they can ask any questions. You know, and for parents to really just let kids know that there are no bad questions. We might not know how to answer all the questions, but they can ask their questions. And we'll be honest about what we can answer and what we can't. And include them as much as possible.
Right. And what tips or strategies can be used by parents to help support a child who's grieving?
One of the places to really start is to be very aware of the power of language. And what I find happens quite often is parents are hesitant to use words such as cancer or dying or death. And so they'll use euphemisms, or instead of saying cancer, they might say, well, mommy's sick.
Yeah.
And that can be really confusing to kids, because especially younger kids, their experience of sickness is sickness goes around the daycare, right? Mm. One gets sick and then the next person gets sick. And so when they next get sick, there's no way for them to decipher that the same thing's not going to happen. Right? So that's why even when I'm working with 2 and 3 year olds, I'm very clear around, no, mommy has cancer. It's different than a cold or the flu. Mm-hmm. You can kiss mom, you can hug mom, you're not going to get cancer from mom. It doesn't work that way.
Right.
And it's also not anybody's fault. And really emphasizing that. But even with death and dying, very often parents don't want to say the words death, dying. So they say passed away, passed on is very common.
Yeah.
Which older kids usually get that, but younger kids, that's very abstract. It doesn't mean anything to them. Sometimes people will say, well, you know, it's like grandma's sleeping. She's having a long sleep, which is terrifying to kids.
Yes.
But even very well-intended things like, you know, well, grandpa will always be in your heart. I've worked with a number of kids who were actually terrified because they physically thought grandpa was in their heart.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So they take things very concretely. And that's where, even with really young kids, just use the words death and dying. Right? Like when we see a dead squirrel on the street, one strategy is to just be like, okay, well, I'm just going to walk by it and make sure my kid doesn't see it.
Yeah.
A much more healthy strategy is to be like, okay, here's a teachable moment where it's not a highly emotional experience.
Right, right.
Let's talk about the dead squirrel. The squirrel's dead. Its body doesn't feel anything anymore. It's not your fault. But its body doesn't feel cold or hot or any pain. Its body will never work again. And that's where, as much as possible, I encourage people to seize the teachable moment. When somebody dies in Disney, which somebody always dies in Disney, right? The dead squirrel, the pet goldfish dies. Ideally, we start teaching kids about death then. And so when it happens in their personal life, it's not the first time they're hearing about it.
That's excellent advice. And how does your approach to supporting a child who's grieving the loss of a loved one due to illness differ from a child who's grieving the loss of a loved one due to a violent death, such as suicide, accident, or crime?
I mean, there's much more shock often involved when it's a violent or unexpected death of any kind, whether it's violent or not. So it can take a long time to help kids and adults wrap their head around the reality of what's happened in their life. However, I mean, even when I'm preparing kids for an expected death, there's a big difference between intellectually knowing somebody's going to die in your life and then emotionally actually knowing that, which often doesn't happen until the person dies anyway. But I'm very, very conscious in the families that I work with, which are the bulk of families that I work with, where somebody is dying in their life, that there's some really, it's a golden opportunity. I mean, what we do leading up to that death changes the story in many ways for the child grieving the death for the rest of their life, really.
Right.
And that's where what my hope is that a child can go through that experience, and yes, it's going to be heartbreaking because this person died, and that's totally natural that it's heartbreaking. But what I'm hoping is that kids aren't coming out of it feeling like, oh, all the adults knew, but they didn't tell me. So now I'm having trouble trusting the adults in my life.
Right.
You know, or most kids, if they have a parent die, they're automatically going to worry about another caregiver if they're in a two-parent family or whoever a surviving caregiver is.
Yeah.
Right? So if that family has a history of withholding the truth, even though it's very well-intended, with the intention usually of protecting the child, unfortunately, it often backfires where a child now feels like, my family doesn't tell me when really hard things go on, and that increases their anxiety. So when it's an expected death, I'm really going to do everything I possibly can to make sure that the child feels included, has a chance to say goodbye to the person, all of those pieces. Whereas when it's unexpected, that looks very different.
Mm-hmm.
But some of those pieces are still really relevant. Like how do we say goodbye to somebody even though they're not physically here? How do we stay in relationship with somebody even though they're not physically here?
Mm-hmm.
So there's elements of those pieces that are the same.
And to build on that, many funeral directors that we've worked with have mentioned that most parents don't bring their children to the funeral or memorial service of a loved one.
Mm-hmm.
In order to protect them from those feelings of pain associated with death and grief. What are your thoughts on that?
I mean, I absolutely encourage families to bring children to funerals. There was a big Harvard child bereavement study that was done, it was a number of years ago now, by Warden and Silverman, and they were looking more at when a sibling dies, but by far the majority of kids, it was incredibly beneficial for them to participate in the funeral. It was not a traumatic event for them to participate. It was actually a helpful thing.
Yeah.
And my experience is the same, that if children want to be there, they should be there. With young children, I mean, a two-year-old, you're just going to bring the two-year-old or bring the three-year-old. Because even if they don't remember being there, it's part of their story that they were there. And it might not be such a big deal when it's great aunt whoever, but if it's a grandparent, if it's anybody who they have a close relationship to in their life, then that is going to be an important part of their story. They will ask at some day, one point, were they there?
Yeah.
Now, having said this, if we have kids who absolutely don't want to go to a funeral, that's a different story.
Yeah.
Right? I don't want to ever force a child who doesn't want to go. But sometimes the million-dollar question, especially with our tweens and our teens, is, do they not want to go? Or is it more that they just prefer to stay home and play video games, right? Or is there something they're actually scared of, like emotionally?
Yeah.
And that's where I really encourage families. Like, if your child is resistant to going to a funeral or a memorial service, try to figure out, what the fear is behind it. Are they really scared of seeing something that they don't need to be scared of?
Mm-hmm.
Right? And I give the example of, I prepared many kids to go to funerals. And ideally, I actually say, do bring the kids to great aunt, whoever's funeral, or the neighbor down the street who they don't know that well. So their first funeral, again, isn't that emotionally heavy for them, but they learn what happens in some funerals. And so, I always say, so-and-so's body will be in a casket if that's the case, and that's going to be happening. And, you can touch grandpa's body, and it might feel really cold, but it's totally okay to touch it. You're not going to get cancer or any sort of illness from it. And it might feel hard. And so I prepared them. And I had a number of kids come back to me and say, Andrea, his head was there too. And I was like, what do you mean his head was there? They're like, you told us just grandpa's body would be in the casket. And I was like, whoa, for years of my practice, I've been saying that. And apparently kids only think of bodies as neck down. And it wasn't just these kids. It's happened so many times in my practice since, where kids will clarify something. If I say, somebody's buried there or their body's buried there, they'll be, well, where's their head? So I know that kids are very concrete. But, if we have a kid who maybe hasn't to go to a funeral because they're worried they're going to see a headless body, We want to find that out and be able to address that, reassure them that that's not what's actually going to happen, and then find out if they're okay going.
Yeah.
The majority of kids, I only, in my practice of working with hundreds of kids, there's only a small number of kids who really don't want to go or who are really uncomfortable and actually scared for a valid reason, in which case, absolutely, don't bring them, but find a way to have another ceremony or ritual in which they feel in a safe space they're able to say goodbye.
Right.
The vast majority of kids are going to benefit from being there, and the only caution I have, or it's not even a caution, is I just say to parents, you know, if it's somebody who you're really close to and you've got your kids there, make sure you bring, whether it's a babysitter or a distant relative, someone the kids are comfortable with. So if the kids have had too much emotionally and need to leave the funeral or just go into another room,
right,
that the parent doesn't have to go with it, right? Like if my mom's died and I'm at the funeral, I don't want to have to leave with my kids if they've had enough.
Right.
So just putting something in place where you've got other people who can take the kids out of the room if necessary.
Perfect. And what kind of warning signs should parents or guardians be looking for that might indicate that their child needs professional grief counseling to help them get through the grieving process?
You know, I think with this, it really depends, again, what's the relationship that the child had. I mean, if somebody really close to the child dies, such as a parent or a sibling or any sort of custodial caregiver, and I'm biased being a grief counselor, but I think, you know, if families have the resources, it never hurts if there's a counselor that a child could connect with for one or two sessions, almost more educational in nature, just to do that across the board. Because, again, so many kids feel they're responsible in some ways. There's so many misconceptions. And what I find consistently in my practice is just as much as parents want to protect their kids, kids want to protect their parents. And so quite often kids won't necessarily ask all of their questions, especially if it's a situation where a parent's really upset and grieving as well.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, not everyone has the resources to connect with a children's grief program or a private counselor. And so, you know, when that's not an option, I watch out for things such as, you know, is this a child who used to be really, really interested in swimming and loved swimming, and now has quit the swim team, is not participating or going back into activities that the child used to love, right? And it's okay for a week or two, but if after that they're actually not going back and engaging in things that they used to like, that for me is a warning sign. Of course, if we ever have any signs of self-harm or the intention to self-harm or talk about suicide or not wanting to live, all of those things as well, automatically we want to get somebody who's well-equipped to support the child. Sometimes what we'll see is that there's a lot of anger management struggles. For a lot of people who are grieving, it's easier to be mad than sad, right? So it might be that the child's lashing out a lot, and that's rooted in grief. And often as adults, we feel that way. We've got a lot of rage when someone dies, too.
Mm-hmm.
So again, like ideally, get somebody who can work with the kids. Or what I encourage families to do is, you know, if the parent themselves is able to reach out and get some, it's almost coaching more than anything, but connect with a grief counselor who is experienced with children, that's an option too. And then quite often I'll work with parents and coach parents so they can help their kids deal with these things.
Right.
But again, as soon as we get into kids not wanting to re-engage in anything that they used to love is doing, or talking about self-harm and things like that, panic attacks, if kids are having panic attacks or anxiety attacks, you know, we don't want to leave a kid struggling with that for a long time. We want to get them formal help for that.
Right. Thank you so much, Andrea, for joining me today. This has been a pleasure.
Oh, my pleasure, Courtney.
Thanks. This is Courtney from Love Lives On. Thank you for watching. If you like what you see, please subscribe to our YouTube channel for more ways we can celebrate our loved ones' lives now and forever.